In this video, we're going to talk about probability. Let's start with an example. What's the probability of rolling a 1? For a die, we could roll it many, many times to get a sense of what fraction of the times it comes up 1. We can also think about, well, there are 6 sides to this die, and only one of the sides has a 1. And since this is a fair die, each side is equally likely to come up, which means we have a 1 in 6 chance of getting a 1. We might also think, what's the probability of getting a 1 or a 2? So again, we can kind of go through the reasoning. We can see, well, one of the sides has a 1. We have a side that has a 2, and a 3, and a 4, and a 5, and a 6. So 2 of our 6 sides has a 1 or a 2. And since each of these sides we know to be equally likely, we have a 1/3 chance of rolling a 1 or a 2. Probability is a set of rules that we use to characterize randomness. It helps us think about what is the chance that something's going to happen. Usually it's used to model random processes, but it can also be used for non-random processes. So you can think about the stock market. The stock market may look very, very random, but each individual action that's taken within the stock market is somebody's particular choice about what they want to buy or sell a stock for. And that isn't really random. But with the system as a whole, it looks very random, and modeling it as random can actually be extremely useful. As we go through this video for an introduction to probability, we're going to go over some of the basic principles. The first of these principles is disjoint, also called mutually exclusive events. So if we think back to rolling a 1 or a 2, these are what are called disjoint events. Because when we roll a die, we can't have both of these outcomes happen. We can't have both a 1 and a 2 for a single roll. Since they can't happen together, we call them mutually exclusive or disjoint events. There's also a rule associated with disjoint and mutually exclusive events. If we were to say, what is the probability of rolling a 1 or a 2? Since these are disjoint events, we can say that the probability of rolling a 1 or a 2 is equal to the probability of rolling a 1 plus the probability of rolling a 2. And since each of these sides are equally likely of rolling a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6 on a die, we have 1/6 for 1 and 1/6 for 2. And we get the same answer that we had reasoned earlier. We can also do this for more sides. So let's say we wanted to do a probability of a 1, or a 2, or a 3, or a 5. Since each of these different outcomes is mutually exclusive, that is, they can't happen at the same time, we can say that this probability is probability of 1 plus probability of 2 plus probability of 3 plus probability of 5. And again, each of these are going to be 1/6. And we're going to have 4/6, or 2/3. We're using what's called the addition rule for disjoint events. You might wonder, what happens when the outcomes aren't disjoint? So for example, if we have a deck of cards, we have 52 different cards, we have 4 suits, spades, hearts, clubs, and diamonds. And within each suit, we have a 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, jack, queen, king, and an ace. Let's start by talking about what's the probability if we draw a random card from the deck that it's a diamond. With 52 cards in the deck and 13 diamonds, and since we're drawing a random card from the deck, each card has an equally likely chance. So we have 13 over 52. So this is going to be 1/4. We can also ask the question of what's the probability of that card we draw being a face card? Face cards are the jacks, queens, and kings, and we have 3 of those in each suit, so we have 12 of those cards. out of 52 cards. And that's going to give us a probability of 3 divided by 13, which is about 0.231. We also might wonder, what's the probability of the card we draw being a diamond or a face card? It's okay if it's a diamond and a face card. One thing we have to notice is that there are some face cards that are also diamonds. So we can't use our addition rule for disjoint events. We need to tweak our formula. So let's start by drawing a Venn diagram. If this circle on the left represents all the diamond cards, and the circle on the right represents face cards, then we would have 3 cards that are face cards and also diamond cards. We'd have 10 cards that are diamond cards, but not face cards. And we'd have 9 cards that are face cards, but not diamonds. You can also think about all of the cards not included in these circles. So we have 52 cards in the deck. There's going to be 30 other cards out here. So let's start our addition formula by first counting up all the cards that are diamonds. That's going to be 13 cards, so we're going to say 13 cards out of our 52 cards, plus the cards that are face cards, so we have 12 of those. So the probability of those 12 cards is 12 out of 52. And if we wanted to actually compute this probability of diamond or face card, now we need to recognize that we've actually double counted this middle group here. The 3 was included in both the 13 and the 12. So we need to subtract out the 3 once. And this is going to give us our probability. This is going to give us our probability of 22 out of 52. It's 11 over 26. So now one thing we should notice here is that we have actually this probability here is the probability of a diamond. This one here is probability of a face card. And this probability that we subtracted out here, that's the probability of drawing a card which is a diamond and a face card. And there's only 3 of those. This is an example of what we call the general addition rule for probability. If we were to write that general rule out more formally, we'd say probability of A or B, where A and B are two possible events. So for example, A could be representing drawing a diamond card, and B could be representing drawing a face card, is equal to the probability of A plus the probability of B minus the probability of A and B. So if A is representing drawing a diamond card, then it's like we have our probability of A here, and if B is representing a face card, then probability of B here, and then minus probability of A and B here. And again, this is our general addition rule. And this formula always holds. If we want to compute the probability of one event A or event B happening, either one happening, we can compute each probability separately and then subtract out what's called the intersection, the probability of both happening. Because all we're doing is we're just removing the double counting. Next, we're going to spend some time talking about probability distributions. A probability distribution is a list of all possible disjoint outcomes and their probabilities. A probability distribution must satisfy 3 different rules. First, the outcomes must be disjoint. Second, each probability must be between 0 and 1. And lastly, the total of the probabilities must equal 1. Let's do an example. We have 3 different distributions for incomes for households in the United States. However, only one of them is valid. The other two are not actually probability distributions. For each of these possible distributions, what we can do is think about each of our 3 different rules. So for our first rule, the outcomes must be disjoint. So in this case, they are disjoint as long as our, for example, $25,000 is, say, in the lower group and not in the next group. So this would be like $25,001 to $50,000. So in this case, they're all disjoint. Second rule, each probability must be between 0 and 1. So for our first set, all of them are between 0 and 1. Our second set, one of them is not. One of them is smaller than 0. That is not possible. Number 2 cannot be our probability distribution. The third one also has values between 0 and 1. Our last rule is that the probabilities in the distribution must total 1. In this first distribution, if we add all these up, we're going to get 1.06. So that means that the first one doesn't work. We could also check the second one. It actually does add up to 1. And we can also check the third one, and it also adds up to 1. Since C satisfies all of our 3 rules, it's our probability distribution. And since in this case we are told that one of these 3 sets was the actual household income distribution for the United States, it must be C. In our next topic, we're going to work with what's called a complement, which you can kind of think as leftovers. So let's say that I give you a set of 100 numbers and that these numbers added up to 1. And I wanted you to tell me, what's the sum of the first 99 numbers? Would you take those 99 numbers and add them all up? Or could you find a shortcut? A shortcut would be to take our total 1, since we know that when we add up all the numbers, they add up to 1, and we could just subtract off the last value. And that would leave the total of the rest. So in a clever way, instead of adding up all of the 99 numbers, we found a shortcut where we can still find that total, but we can find it in a much more efficient way. This is the principle of a complement. If we have a probability distribution, and we want to find the probability of an event A, we can take just 1 minus the probability of what's called A complement, which is basically just the probability of all the other possible outcomes in our probability distribution. This is useful when it's easier to compute the probability of the complement than the probability of the event more directly. If we think back to our probability distributions context, if we wanted to find the probability of a randomly selected household of having its income between $0 and $100,000, then we could add up our first 3 probabilities. Or what we could do is we could take 1 minus the probability of the last category. And that would give us our same result. In this case, 0.84. The last topic we're going to talk about is independence. We say 2 processes are independent if knowing about the outcome of one provides no useful information in understanding the other process. So we can think about the probability of rolling a 1. So if I told you that I rolled an even number, would this influence what you think the probability of a 1 is? Of course. If it's an even number, then the probability of a 1 is 0, since 1 isn't an even number. On the other hand, if I told you that it was an odd number, then the probability would be higher than what you originally thought without this information. So these different possible outcomes, 1, even, and odd, all relate to each other. That is, they aren't independent. Rolling a 1 is not independent of rolling an even number. Similarly, rolling a 1 is not independent of rolling an odd number. So these are not independent events. If you're curious, it was a 4. We can also think about the chance of rolling a first die and getting a 1, a second die and getting a 1, and a third and also getting a 1. So if we roll one die, and then we roll a second die, and a third die, we can think, what's the probability that all of them came up 1? And importantly, are these events, the probability of each die coming up 1, in any way related to each other? If the first one I rolled was a 1, would that have any influence on the other one? If the first two I rolled are 1s, would that have any influence on the third one? In general, things like rolling a die or flipping a coin are independent processes. That is, the dice are not subtly communicating with each other about, hey, you rolled a 1, well then I can't roll a 1. They don't do that. So if we think about these probabilities separately, the probability of the first die being a 1, that's 1/6. Probability of the second die being a 1, that's also 1/6. And probability of the third die being a 1, that one is also 1/6. So if 1/6 of the time my first roll is going to be a 1, then of that 1/6 time, 1/6 of those times, the second die will also be a 1. That means 1 out of every 36 times, I'll get a 1 for both the first and the second dice. And then, of that 1/36 of the time, 1/6 of those times, I'll also get a 1 for the third roll. So in this case, all we've really done is compute each probability separately, since these are what are called independent events, and then we've multiplied them together. We've used what's called the multiplication rule for independent processes. So if you have two possible outcomes, A and B, and we're looking for the probability of both A and B happening, then if A and B are independent, then this probability is equal to probability of A times probability of B. And similarly, we can expand out to using more events too. So one thing I want to call out is that for the multiplication rule for independent processes, we're looking at the probability of A and B. And we also have that we're using multiplication. And always, it's really this assumption, this condition, is extremely important. If A and B were not independent, this formula would not hold. I also want to bring back our general addition rule. So for our general addition rule, our focus is on A or B, not A and B. And this formula actually held for any type of events. And in this case, we use a plus and a minus rather than a multiplication. If you found this video interesting, I'd recommend checking out one of our textbooks on openintro.org. You can actually download a PDF completely for free, and if you want to get a paperback or a hard copy, they're also very affordable. If you have any questions, please leave them in the comments. Thanks for watching.